Technique 2 is an updated version of the original Professor Bailey Talks rider technique. As you know, as time goes on, things change. Well, the motorcycles change a little every year, and about every 10 years there's a major change. Well, the same for riding techniques. If you want to keep up with the competition, you need to keep up with those changes in techniques. Nobody cares what we did 30 years ago, or even 10 years ago to win races. Sure, some of those things still work today, but we need to know what the newest techniques are as well. If you don't make changes, you're not going to win today. If you're going to try to be competitive on a 10-year-old motorcycle, it's not going to work. Bikes change because of testing. Someone always trying to make them better. Well, as the bikes get better, the riders can do more things more easily. Then, as the riders get better, they learn more about how they want the bike set up. So it's easier to go fast. So, can you ride the old bikes with the new style? Well, sure, somewhat. Can you ride the old style with the new bikes? Sure, but you're going to work too hard. And why do that? Update your techniques and make your life easier. If you do have an older bike, even from the 70s, you can still use most of these techniques. However, you don't have as much travel, and the suspension won't let you do some things. Plus, the seats don't go as far forward, so it's harder for you to sit that far forward on the bike to weight the front end. But it can be done. The suspension? Well, you're not going to do any of those big airtime jumps or go flying through those stadium whoops. But with the right position on the bike, you can do some of those, only at a slower speed. So what's the best position to be in and why? Well, pretty much stay in the center of the motorcycle. Yes, in the middle, just like someone riding a horse. There's a lot less chance of being thrown off, whether you're standing or sitting, if you stay in the middle of the bike. You know, as I look back 10, 20, 30 years, or even 40 years ago, some of the best and the fastest riders rode forward. And some of these riders didn't even train much, if any. They still could ride with the best in the world. Let's start with McGrath. He rides forward, way forward, most of the time. And so does Mikel Plachon. Before that, there was Stanton and Bradshaw when he was at his peak. Then in the 80s, there was Bale, Johnson, Bailey. And then there was Lachine and Marty Trias. These two guys didn't like to train and still went fast, because they knew how to let the bike do the work for them by standing in the center of it. Then in the 60s and 70s, there was DeCosta, who made everything look so smooth and so easy, and he rode forward, even when the bikes weren't set up to ride that way. And Joel, a guy that was overweight and didn't like to train, he stood up a lot, rode in the center of the bike. And when I look back 30-some years and see most of the fastest riders in the world rode in the center and forward on the bike, I ask you, can it be a bad place to be? I don't think so. So let's look more at that riding position. With your bike on the stand, stand up on the balls of your feet, keeping your legs fairly straight, putting the same amount of weight on the bars as there is on the pegs. Now, be sure your legs aren't too bent. In fact, the more your legs are straight, the better it is. If you really want to see how it works, straighten the legs all the way. You can now let the bike float from the front end or the back end over anything with very little movement. If you simply move or lean forward 6 inches, you will find that you are light on the pegs. This can let you soak up an impact to the rear wheel. When you're looking for the best traction on the front end to make it stick and turn, or get the front fork angle tighter, body position is very important. Riding with your legs straight or bent can change how much you need to work or not work to get the front end up. Just try riding with your legs bent or straight, and you will feel the difference. If you want to see how much difference there is, while your bike is on the stand, have someone get behind you and lift your feet from the pegs while you are in the neutral position. Then move to the rear and you will see you are now heavier on the pegs. Also try this, go back to the center. Now, just bend your legs and watch how much weight transfers to the rear. You see riders jumping with their legs all bent and they can't figure out why they can't get the front end down without using the rear brake. Well, it's a lot harder to lighten up on the rear and put weight on the front with your legs bent. The straighter, the better once you go in the air. Keep your arms more bent and a low profile with your upper body. The more you can keep your arms up and out, the more leverage and control you will have. In order to keep those arms up and out, you will need the right hand grip. So what is that? Well, the bar shouldn't lay in your hands at a 90 degree angle. Turn the palms of the hands out so that you feel the pressure more on the outside palm as you push down on the grips. I call this the tennis grip. With this grip, you will find that your arms will stay more up and out away from you as your body goes forward and into the bike. Some riders try to keep their arms up without this grip, and as they get tired, the arms drop. If the grip is right, it's hard to drop your arms. Another advantage to this grip, it will make you ride more forward and make you more aggressive when you are forward. Also, be sure you aren't riding with your grip all the way to the inside of the grips. Keep your palms out near the end, but don't let them hang over. While we are talking about the best riding position, we need to talk about riding on the balls of the feet. Yes, on the balls of the feet. And why? Well, because you will be able to work with the motorcycle better, meaning that you can work with the suspension better. More suspension you have, the softer the ride. And your legs are suspension. When you land off a jump, don't make your motorcycle suspension do all the work. If you are in the arches, more weight goes into the suspension. Try jumping in the air, landing flat-footed, then on the balls of your feet, and see what I mean. All sports are played on the balls of the feet so that you can move more quickly and easier. Soccer, basketball, boxing, tennis, you name it. So why not motorcycles? Other problems with not riding on the balls of the feet? If you ride in the arches, you will ride with your toes pointed out so that you won't hit the shift lever or the brake pedal. Then you will find as you move into the bike and you bend your legs, your knees go out away from the bike, losing grip. If you are landing from a jump and your knees go out, you can't grip the bike. Then you are going to be pulled to the rear. And the only way you have to hold on is to hold on to the bars tighter to keep yourself forward. You can also try this while standing. Put your toes out and squat. If you are on the balls of your feet, you can keep your toes pointed forward, because they are behind the brake pedal and the shift lever. And now, when you compress, your knees grip the bike. Here's one other thing you can try. Going around a turn, now, put your foot on the outside peg, in the arch, and push. Then do it on the ball of the foot, and you will find that you can put more pressure on the peg from the ball of the foot. This makes it easier to weight the outside peg in the turn. Then make like you are coming out of a turn and you need to stand up quickly. Do it first from the arches, then do it from the ball of the foot. And again, you will find it's easier to stand from the ball. So are these the only reasons? No. If you are on the balls of your feet as much as possible, when you are not shifting or braking, you are going to be lighter on the pegs and the bike is going to work better underneath you. So why don't we ride on the balls of our feet? Because it's not easy, and we have never done it. Besides, we want to have our feet close to the brake pedal and the shifter. Work on it. You will be lighter on the bike, land softer, plus you will have a better grip and more control. Gripping the bike is very important. Grip the bike with your legs. You don't need a death grip, you just need a grip so that you can go with it. The more you grip with your legs, the looser you can be with your hand grip. And that means less chance of arm pump, plus a better flow with the bike. It is important that you grip when standing and while seated. When standing, grip with both legs against the tank seat and side panels and with your feet. This grip will not only keep you going with the bike, it will keep you from being pitched off if the bike kicks some hole, bump, or jump. The same goes for the turns. Grip the bike, only this time you will do most of the gripping with your outside leg. The leg grip will do two things. One, keep you going with the bike when you power, and two, it will help you to keep the bike laid over in the turn. If you happen to stick your foot into the ground, you won't be drug off the back of the seat. When you practice, work on your riding position. Work on keeping your head not just over the bars, but more in front of the bars. The more you go forward, the more aggressive you can be, and the more aggressive you are going to be because you are forward. Even most of the top pro riders ride too far back and chase the front end all day. The only one that's out there is McGrath. I mean out there. There are some that are close to the front, leading the bike, and they are the ones that are close to Jeremy. I have said for years that if you rode the whole track, like it were the start, weight forward, over the front end, and charging as hard as we do when we come off the gate, no one could catch us. Well, take a good look at Jeremy from the turn, off the jump, through the whoops, anytime he gasses it. He has that look. So what more can I say about the best riding position? Be sure that once you have that forward riding position on the bike, that you have an arch in your back, a little hunched over, rounded shoulders. Don't let your back go flat. If you have a flat back, you can't work with the bike in a flowing motion. You need to be able to roll forward coming off the jump. Work with the front end and the rear in the whoops and keep the front stable in the turns. And so you can do that and have more control, you need to be more over the front end. Arms up and out. If you want to have more control, keep the arch in your back and the bike can work more freely under you. While we're talking arch back, don't forget that tennis grip, which will put you more forward with your arms out, making it easier to round your shoulders.
Defensive riding. Most riders don't ride defensive enough. They're not ready for things. It's a surprise when someone comes on the inside and tries to take them out. Or they come off the jump and the bike kicks sideways or throws the front end down. The wheel goes over a berm or splits a rut. The front end washes out in a turn or the rear end comes around exiting the corner. Why? They're not ready. Be defensive. Just like a tennis player or a boxer moves and keeps moving. Sure, why not? Be ready. Stay more loose on the bike. All you need to do is work the bike a little everywhere. Don't just think that you're in the right position and stay there. Sure, you may be in the right place on the bike if everything goes perfect, but what are the chances of that on a motocross track? Things change quickly. A wheel washes out, the back end tries to slide around. You never know. When you are riding, think defensive. like, okay, give me something. Go ahead. I'm ready. Forward momentum. Keeping a good forward momentum is very important in all forms of racing. The more you stop or slow, the harder it is to get back up to speed. It's not the guy that goes the fastest that wins the race. It's the guy that slows down the least. Sure, you can charge down the straightaway too hard, overbraking, losing speed. Then try giving it too much power and break the rear wheel loose and lose again. The same goes for the whoops. If you slow too much at the entrance, you can't get it going once you're in them. Then on the jumps, don't slow too much. Well, then it comes to the turns. You need to learn good braking, front and rear, and carry a good speed through the turns, and be sure that you're going with the bike. Lean a little forward, make the bike come to you, just like on the start. Then, when you come to the jumps, try not to go back on the bike, go with it. If you push back on the takeoff, you will at some time need to pull yourself forward again. When you do that, you are pulling on the bars, pulling the bike backwards. And if the front was high on the takeoff, you are going to pull it even higher. Then more than likely you'll push on the rear brake to lower the front end, slowing the bike even more. Stay forward with your head, butt to the rear a little. Grip with your legs. As the bike leaves the jump, roll forward with it, flying with it over the top. Then, as it lands, go with it. Compress and rebound forward, creating forward momentum. And at the same time, the power should be coming on hard and smooth. Then when it comes to the whoops, don't get too far back or the front end too high. If the front is too high, it will pull the rear wheel down into the holes, hitting too much of the face and slowing the momentum. Plus, when the front slaps down, the forks will rebound back, again slowing forward momentum. If you are too far back on the bike, there is too much weight on the rear, putting it in the bottom of each whoop, and that again slows momentum. So you can keep a better forward momentum, you need to keep the bike as flat as possible, as much as possible, and a controlled power all the way through the whoops. Sometimes you can go faster if your timing is perfect than if you try to go wide open. The trick? Learn to go fast without beating yourself to death. The clutch is one of the most important things next to a good body position that you can learn if you want to go fast, safe, and consistent. I hate to say it, but there are a lot of top pro riders that don't use it right. Sure, they do in some places on the track, but not in others. Anyone that has followed the professor's techniques for the last 15 years knows that I have always preached, use your clutch. If you use it right, it works. If you use it and do it wrong, it still works, but not as well. Plus, you can cook a lot of clutches if you use it wrong. The word is feed the clutch. Don't dump it. Don't slip it. If you dump it, you're going to wheelie if there's too much traction, or spin it if there's not enough traction. On the other hand, if you slip it, you're not going anywhere, and your clutches are not going to last long. Use the clutch feed, just like on the start. As the gate drops, you release the lever quickly but smoothly. The trick? Get it better than everyone else.
When and where do we use the clutch and why? Well, it all comes down to this. It's a race from the gate to the first turn, then from the first turn to the second, and so on. The only thing is, we now have obstacles. If it's a jump, get forward, drive up the jump, and you may need some power. To be sure what kind of power, help it with the clutch. Then comes the landing. Here you want to be as aggressive as possible, just like on the start. So it's time to get on the front end.
and ready to go. Now, get the clutch ready too. And as the bike starts to land, start with the same kind of power as if you were doing a start. Drive hard and fast. And if there's another jump just after that, do the same thing again. Then comes that set of whoops. Now, everyone is a little different. If it's a jump in and hammer, get in, get forward, get the clutch, feed it and go. And those kind of whoops, you may not need it again, but still keep the finger on it. Sure, leave the finger on the lever. You never know what's going to happen. If it's whoops where you need more timing, setting the front wheel down and picking it up again, the clutch will make it easier. Plus, you can try a taller gear so that you can go faster. Without the clutch, you may not be able to go to that taller gear without bogging. How many fingers do you use on the clutch? One. Sure, you can use two or three, but there is a problem. The more fingers on the lever, the less grip you have. Also, the more fingers on the lever, the faster you are going to release it. Why? Because you will want to get the grip back onto the bars. The other reason? The less fingers, the smoother the release. And why is that? Because you can't pull it in as far. If you have one finger on the lever, you can only pull it in this far. Then, with two fingers on the lever, you can pull it in a little further, and with three, even further. Now, when you want to have power, you want it now, and you want it smooth. The lever is not in as far, so it's easier to find what the perfect engagement point is. If it's in too far and you try to feed it, you may not go at first. So, you hurry the release. Where is the clutch just before the gate falls? Out as far as possible, just before the bike starts to go forward. That's where it should be when you start to use it. Lube the clutch pivot point and the cable so that it will work as smooth and as easy as possible. Don't let the feel of the clutch fool you when you are sitting still. It works easier when it's running. Why leave your finger on all the time? So that you're ready. The other reason is McGrath, Vail, Bailey, Albertine, Hughes, Lampson, Mikhail Pouchon, you name it, they all keep their fingers on the clutch, or finger on the clutch. Setup. So you can ride in the right position, your bike needs to be set up right. So here are some things to look for. First, your bars, make sure that they don't have too much sweep back. Look for bars that are a little straighter. This will help to get you more over the front end. No matter what bike you are on, look for the Answer Suzuki bin, or if it's a Renthal, the McGrath or the Henry bin. Don't get them too tall or with too much sweep back. If it's for a Mini, use the Mini Lows and ask for the straightest bar they have. Width with grips on 31 to 31 and a half inches for the big bikes, and 28 to 29 and a half inches for the Minis. This will work best for most riders. Then, when you put the bars on the bike, don't drop the ends of the bars too low. Don't drop them lower than the rise. They can either be as flat as possible or the ends can be up just a little. The more the ends are up, the more aggressive you can be. Why not the higher bars? Well, it's fine if you were standing all the time, but when you sit down for the turns, they'd be too high. Levers, don't put them up too high or too straight out. Put the levers down a little, but not too low. Most of the time, about a 30 degree angle works well. However, this one you can play with to see what you like best. Foot levers, your levers should be about level with the peg, so that you can get to the shifter for an easy upshift or downshift. The rear brake should be higher than the foot peg, so that it's level under full braking. If it sits level from the start, your foot goes down too far under braking. This could be a problem in deep ruts, or if your foot's on the brake when you case something. But most importantly, it changes your position too much going into the turn. If you stand up and get in your aggressive position for going into the turn, then start to brake, you will see that your right knee goes forward a lot. Then you bring your other knee forward to match it. Now you have too much weight on the front and nothing on the rear. Even though 70% of the controlled braking is in the front brake, the back is now doing nothing. And this lets the rear end hop and kick. So you want the weight on the front, sure, but you need some on the rear. With the brake higher, you get the best of both worlds. As far as the suspension goes, there are a lot of things to know if you want it right, and I don't want to take the time from this video. However, I do have a race prep and suspension tuning video that goes into detail on this subject. Most important though, be sure it's not too quick on the rebound on the front or on the rear. And watch that you don't make it too slow, that it packs up and gives you a rough ride. Try to get both ends the same for the best control. One more thing before we finish with the motorcycle. Watch that the seat foam does not get too beat, too soft. It will make you set too low in the bike and make it harder for you to get up on the front end for the corners. And if it gets soft, change it. Helmet visor is very important to have it right. No matter how hard you try to have the perfect form, the perfect riding position, if your helmet visor is too low, you're going to have a hard time doing it. Look at all the top riders, and you can see somewhere between an inch to an inch and a half of the helmet under the visor. If the visor is too low, and you get in the aggressive and intact riding position, you can't see. So you bend your legs and straighten your back. Now your form is bad. Move it up as high as possible. Look in a mirror. If you can't see that inch to an inch and a half, redrill the holes. It's better to have it too high than too low. This is something that everyone is doing, not just McGrath. Boy, this must be a real important one.
Wheelies, do you need to know how to do them? Well, maybe the wheelie itself isn't that important, but the techniques you use to do the wheelies are. Like how you get the front end up with ease, how to get traction so that you can loft the front, good throttle and clutch control, rear brake control, plus getting better balance. Hey, besides, if you can do a wheelie, slow and controlled, how cool are you? I'll bet most of your buddies can't. So, what do you need to do? Well, start with a stand-up wheelie. And let's think of it as a loft at first. Pick it up and carry it two or three bike lengths and set it down. Then as you get better, you can go further. Ride along slow, standing. Legs straight and grip the bike with your head forward. Now, compress the forks a little. If you need to, use the rear brake and leave your foot just over the brake. Now, as the forks are rebounding, give it a pull along with a little power. You can do it without the clutch, but it's easier if you use it a little. Now, as the front end starts to come up, lean back a little, not too much, and don't let your foot get away from that brake. If the front end gets too high, pull the clutch and tap the rear brake. Keep working on this until you feel comfortable with it. And keep it at a slow speed, first gear only in a low power band. Next, try to do a wheelie sitting down, but again, a slow wheelie, not a horsepower one. This time, sit in the middle of the seat. If you are too far forward, it's hard to loft the front wheel. And if you are too far back, it's harder to control once you have it up. So start with the center, ride along slow, pull the clutch, tap the rear brake, compress the forks. Now you will need your upper body forward so that you can yank on the bars as the forks rebound. Again, use your clutch so that you have the right power. Then, as the front comes up, lean back a little. Don't try to go too far at first, just get the feel. And keep your foot on that rear brake so that you don't go over. If you find that the bike keeps falling to one side, it's because you're too tense. Be more defensive as you pick it up, move a little left to right so that you won't get too far gone one way or the other. Take your time and you'll get it. Play riding is very important. You bet all of the top riders do it. You can learn a lot from playing off the track. I think the number one problem with most riders, they never go out and ride up or down steep cliffs. They don't ride the trails. They don't get where the real ruts are, in the tight stuff. They want to ride where it's easy on the track and they want that smoothed out. Learn to do the technical things at slow speed, then pick it up. Go fast and see if you can still keep it under control. All of the things you do off the track will help you on the track. In every school, the first thing we do is a little slow follow the leader. And there are minis and some of the older riders that can't get up a 6-foot bank without losing control, or going across a 3-foot wide ditch without slamming their front or rear wheel into it. The track is too easy. That's why some riders never learn good control. Before we get into on-track techniques, we need to take a look at tires. Having the right tire for each track is very important. So here is a chart that will help you pick the best tire for the track that you are riding on. Proper braking is an important part of learning how to go faster. If you want the most effective braking possible, learn to use both brakes, front and rear. The brakes are like power. You can use them too hard, stopping too much, or sliding the rear wheel, or not using them enough. The braking should be like a tractor, slowing as fast as possible and under control. Don't pull the clutch in going into a turn. If you do, it will make the bike freewheel, picking up speed. Then, when you use the rear brake, it's easier to lock up the rear wheel, sliding it and losing control entering the turn. If you are sliding it going into the corner, then you are pushing on the brake too hard. Work on getting a better feel of the rear brake. Don't just mash it. Apply pressure softly and easily. Practice stopping as quick as possible without stalling it. Now for the front brake. The front brake is 70% of the controlled stopping. Using both brakes can stop you faster than just the rear. When you work on the front brake, stay forward. The more you are forward, the better the brake will work. Whether you are standing or sitting, stay forward. If you're standing, keep your head over the bars for the best braking and control. But it's okay to get your butt back. In fact, if your butt is back, you'll have better braking on the rear. If you are sitting while braking, stay forward up to the gas cap. Wait on the front. And because you are seated, you will be keeping the rear wheel down as well. If the bike wants to skid or tries to stall, or even kicks up going into the turn, you can give it a little power while under braking. Don't hold the power on, play with it. A little blip on and off. This will keep the wheel turning, making it more stable and giving it more control. The start. Well, other than crossing the finish line first, the start is the most important part of the whole race. And in order to get to the first turn in first place, you need good reaction and good traction. The reaction may be a little harder to practice, because there is nothing quite like being on the start line with 39 other riders. However, you can practice with someone else starting you, with or without a gate. Of course, if you have a starting gate, it's a lot more like race day. Plus, you will be able to work on your reaction, watching the pin that makes the gate fall. Another way that works well is to start with another rider and watch his clutch lever. When he takes off, you go and see if your technique is better than his. When you try this, line up on the left-hand side of the other guy. He should give you a 2 to a 5 second warning, just like on race day. Then watch his lever close. As he starts to let it out, go. If you can stay within a bike length, you've made a pretty good start. If it's a half a bike length, you've done real good. And if you beat him to the first turn, well, you're either really good or he's real bad. Each time you start, change off. One time he's the key man, next time you are. Now for the best techniques so that you can get out first. Stay forward on the seat with your head forward over the bars and grip the bike with your legs. When you take off, you don't want to be sliding back on the seat, and you don't want your feet flying back behind the pegs. If you are starting in second gear, start with both feet down. If you watch closely, you will see that most all of the top riders start this way for more control and a more consistent start. If you are starting in first gear, you may want one foot on the peg. I suggest that be the left one so that you can shift quickly. Most all 250, 500 riders start in second gear, as do the 60s and most 80s. However, if you're on a 125, start in first gear. I can tell you that almost all the 125 riders start in first gear. The problem with second is you need to feed the clutch too long and you don't get over the gate quick enough so that you can get out ahead of everyone else. And then you get closed off. Sure, you can get a good start in second gear, but not every time. And maybe if you weigh 120 pounds, second gear might work, or maybe even in deep sand. There's always a but and an or an if. But again, the top guys use first gear on 125s. So what about the shift? Well, this can be done a couple of different ways when you have both feet down on the ground. If you have a long second gear, you may have plenty of time to get your feet up to the pegs and then shift. However, if you don't, try this. If your feet are well forward, you may shift with the back of your boot. Or if that's too hard, shift with any part of the boot that you can. Your feet are in front of the pegs as you take off. Now, as you take off, don't be in a hurry to pick up your feet. Just get them up off the ground. Now, when you are ready to shift, pull your foot up and grab the shifter with any part of the boot you can. If you keep your legs into the bike and don't let your legs and feet fly around, you should have no problem shifting after doing it a few times. If you want to get a straighter start on a 125, keep both feet down. And with this technique, you can still shift quickly. Next, the clutch release. Don't snap it out. Don't slip it. Feed it. Letting the clutch out right is what's going to give you the start. Just like on the drag strip, no matter how much power you have, if you let the clutch out too fast, you're going to spin the tire and you lose. First, the RPMs. Keep them up high. 60s, 80s, 125s, full. 250s, half to three-quarter throttle. And if it's a 500, about half throttle. Don't worry about the RPMs being too high. If you let the clutch out smooth, it's not going to be a problem. Next, hold the front brake so that you can let the clutch out as far as possible without the bike going forward. You want to take all the slack out of the chain so that when you start to feed the clutch out, you're going to go forward as quick as possible and with the best traction. How fast you release it will depend upon the ground and what it's like. If it tries to spin, slow the release down. If it wants to wheelie, slow down the release. Keep the RPMs high and the clutch out as quick as possible without spinning or wheeling. Feed it smooth. Beware when you are holding the front brake and letting the clutch out as far as possible so that you're ready to go when the gate drops. Don't be spinning the rear wheel before the gate falls. When you have done it right, you will look the same out 4 or 5 bike lengths as you did when you were sitting at the gate. If you are having a hard time coming out of the gate clean every time, try feeding the clutch 1.5 bike lengths per gear. So if it's second gear, it would be 3 bike lengths that you would feed it. If you're spinning or wheeling, feed it a little longer. The start is about 70% of any race, so work on it if you want to be out first. Corners. Again, like everywhere else, body position is very important. And how you use the power is critical for good traction and control. The importance of the clutch and how you use it. It's just as important as how you use it off the start. So how do you use it? Feed it. Remember, you want the best power, the most control around and out of the turn. If you don't use it, you don't know what kind of power you're going to have. It may be too much, or it may not be fast enough. In most situations, use the start rule, 1.5 bike length speed per gear. This way, you are going to have the best power for the gear that you're in and on those track conditions. First, let's talk about flat turns. You want your weight right so that you are in the right position for the best traction. Don't change your body as you start to lay the bike over. What I am saying is this. As you start laying the bike over, keep your body more upright. And in order to do that, you need to sit more on the outside edge of the seat. And the more you lay it over, the more you will sit on the high side of the seat. Not only do you need to be on the outside edge of the seat, but you want to weight the outside peg. Now, this puts traction on the rear, but what about the front end? Well, you need to be forward on the seat, as far forward as possible, and your outside arm should be up and out away from your body so that you can make the front wheel stick and go where you want it to go. If you sit back on the seat, you can't control the front of the motorcycle because the front wheel is too light, which will cause the front wheel to wash out. Another advantage to being forward is that the forks are more compressed, bringing the steering rake in and making it easier to turn. As you come into the turn, use as much front brake as possible, along with the rear. Remember, 70% of the controlled stopping and slowing is in the front wheel brake. Coming into a corner, set early. Yes, set as soon as possible. If you set earlier, you are more ready when you get to the turn. You can start laying it over sooner, and your leg can be out and ready for the turn. Can you brake as hard? You bet. For one, if you are sitting forward, you have more weight on the front for better braking. Plus, you have weight on the seat, which is keeping the rear end down more. When you are standing, there is not as much weight on the rear wheel. So what about braking bumps? Well, you don't want to be sitting going through those. So just as you're going over the last bump, sit down and get ready for the turn. Now back to that flat turn. As you sit down, get your inside leg up. The more you lay it over, the higher it will need to be. Just make sure that it doesn't make contact with the ground. However, your leg won't need to be as high or as straight like it would be in a berm turn. Grip with your outside leg. This will help you hold on to the front of the seat. Plus, if your foot does touch, you won't be pushed off the rear of the bike. And this leg grip will help lay the bike over in the corner. If you let your leg go out away from the tank going through the turn, it will stand the bike up. Not only should you be forward on the seat, but keep your head over the bars as much as possible. The more you are forward, the more aggressive you can be. And the more aggressive you are, the harder you can gas it. Then, as you come out of the turn, stay forward and over the front end. Lead the bike when you power. If you are thinking you need to slide on the rear of the seat for traction coming out, not. Traction comes from the front with the clutch and throttle, so give it the right power. So, how are berms different? Well, you still sit forward, only your legs should be much higher. Now it's a must. And the more you are forward, the easier it is to do that. Try this. On your bike stand, sit forward at the gas cap. Straighten your leg and lift it as high as possible. Now, slide back a little at a time. You will see that it's harder to keep your leg up as you slide back. This is a problem for many riders. They sit too far back, and if the berm is long, it's hard to hold the leg up there. So it drops and they plant their foot. Just like in a flat turn, sit before you get to the berm so that you're ready before you get there. Now, don't sit on the outside of the seat. Drop down like you would if you were still on a straight. And when you lay it over for the berm, lean with it. If you sit on the outside edge of the seat, you are making the bike stand up when it should be laying over. Remember to stay on the front so that you can make it go where you want it. And again, keep your outside arm up and away from your body for better leverage, balance, and control. If you have a problem going over a berm, look for this. Are you laying the bike over and yourself over far enough? Is your outside arm down too far? Are you exploding the power? And are you looking where you want to go? Too many riders don't know what they are looking at. Look right where you want to go and you will go there. Look about one bike length ahead for each gear that you are in and watch that line. If you still find that you are going wide, try leaning your head in. Lean your head to the inside. This will drop the bike and you over at the same time. By the way, this is for all corners, not just for berms. If you want to know how much to lean your head, look at the front fender. Do what it is doing. Get your helmet visor to do the same thing as the front fender. If it is only leaned a little, then a little may be okay. Work on this. It will make your cornering easier to hold the inside, but it's weird at first. It will take some getting used to. So what about the ruts? A lot like the berm, only there is no room for mistakes, because the rut is only as wide as the tire, or maybe 2 or 3 inches wider on each side. So if something is not perfect, you know it. What I mean is that if you are a little too much to the inside coming into the turn, the front wheel is going to push on the inside of the rut, making you dab your foot, messing up your timing and your momentum. And if you are too high, the wheels are going to go over the top. If this happens, you can't go as aggressive and you can't lay it over as far. And don't lock up the rear wheel going into it. If you do, it's going to slide over the entrance of the rut, even if the front wheel is in the groove. All of this is a loss of forward momentum and control. Stay loose, look where you want to go. Lean with the bike, stay forward, keep your leg high, your arms out and your head in, and feed the power smooth. Off cambers. Why are they so hard for most riders? Because of a lack of control of the front end and the rear end. Of course, you don't want to slide the rear wheel under braking going into an off camber. It's not a good place to try that. Why? Well, if the rear wheel is locked up, it slides, and it's hard to control that slide on the off camber. You want the bike to keep traction under braking and under acceleration most of the time. Under braking, always. Why not most of the time under acceleration? Because sometimes a little slide will help you cut more back to the inside. Be sure you sit down early with your leg out, if possible. Sit on the outside of the seat a little and stay forward. Keep your outside arm up and your head in. You will need your front brake, but don't overdo it. However, the more, the better, just don't lock it up. When it's aggressive and it's right, you will feel a little chatter in the rear. Now, as you get to the apex, that's the middle or the center of the corner, lay it over a little harder so that it will turn tighter and keep you more to the inside. The more you lay the bike over, the tighter corner you can make. Remember to work the bike a little. You don't know when you power what kind of traction you're going to have, and you don't know how much to lay the bike over or stand it up. Be defensive. This can be a good passing place, so work on it until you get it right. Jumping. If there is one place that's important to know safety, confidence, and control, it's on the jumps. For sure, you can get in more trouble here than anywhere else. It's not just knowing how to do the jump, but what to do if it's not right. What do you do if you come up short on that double? Or if you get a bad kick coming off of the takeoff ramp? Or the front end's too high or it's too low? Well, let's start with the best position to be in. No matter what happens, right or wrong, stay in the center of the bike as much as possible. Most riders want to get back too much on the takeoff ramp and in the air. But why? Mostly because they don't want the front end to drop, or they think they are going to go over the front end, so they ride back. Well, you're not going to have either problem if you power on the takeoff and the landing. Learn to go with the bike. Grip. When you leave the ramp, go with it. The more you do that, the more forward momentum you will create and the less energy you will use. If you push back, you then need to pull yourself forward and the bike back. Plus, this takes energy and you don't need to use it. Grip, flow, move with it. Yes, there are some jumps you can't do that because there is a kicker on the ramp or it is too steep. If you try to stay on the front here, you will go nose down. The problem is, you will get more kick from the rear end, so that you will need to be back more to keep the front end lighter. On most all jumps, you want to give it a little power on the takeoff so that the front won't drop, and power on the landing for the softest landing and the fastest getaway. As you go into the face of the jump, use your arms and legs to soak it up, just like the suspension does. Then rebound as you go in the air, rolling up and forward. Then, as you are landing, move into the bike again, soaking up the impact. As you soak it up, keep your upper body low, close to the bars. This will let you be more aggressive with your power. Don't forget, when you give it power, do it with the clutch and throttle. Every jump is a little different on the takeoff as far as what kind of power you will want. The flatter the ramp, the more you can hold it wide open. As the ramp gets steeper, you will need to back off coming up the jump and then power up the ramp. Having a steady power on a steep ramp can be like having no power. The rear end is going to kick up, throwing the front down. Now, here's what you want to do so that you can land on the front or the rear wheel. At the top of the jump, the arc, always be sure that the bike is flat. As you leave the jump and you are rolling your weight forward, unweight the pegs. This will let the rear end lift, dropping the front and leveling out the bike. Now, if you want to land front wheel first, just stay in that position until you land. If you want to land on the rear wheel, lift on the bars a little and power. This will drop the rear end. If you are always flat at the top of the arc, you can land on the front or rear wheel with no problem. If you are jumping a tabletop or a double jump, you want to land on the downside of the second jump for the softest landing and for the best forward momentum. Do you always want to land on the back side of the jump? Yes, if over jumping gives you a hard landing or slows forward momentum. But sometimes over jumping is better. If the jumps are too close together and you need to slow down too much to land on the backside, hit it faster and treat it like a single jump. Jump it as far as possible and look for the best landing spot. If you find a hole where everyone else is landing, try to land just on the other side of that hole. Wherever you are going to land, don't get the front end too high. The higher the front end, the more it will use the rear suspension and the harder it will slam the front down. The problem with the front end high, you can't power until it comes down. If you land with the front end high, it slaps the front end down, rebounding it back at you. If the front's down, the front forks are more straight up and down, and the rebound won't slow down forward momentum. Then, when the shock rebounds, it pushes the bike forward. If you power on landing, you have nothing but forward momentum. No matter what kind of a jump it is, keep it flat when possible. If you need to land on the rear wheel first, the front end should be about 12 to 18 inches higher than the rear. If it's downhill, uphill, or on flat, the flatter the bike on the landing, the better with power on. The most important thing in jumping, keep a good body position. Work on controlling the power, get the bike angle right, and learn to judge the distances where you're going to land.